welcome Professor Noam Chomsky as our distinguished visiting humanities lecturer this year. This is the program we began just a few years ago to bring to our university some of the finest minds in the country, in the spirit of academic freedom, in the spirit of examining the great issues of the day. And it's hard to imagine a more appropriate speaker than Noam Chomsky. He has been, in a funny way, a part of my life since I began at law school in 1971. I had at that time a very close friend who had a PhD from MIT in linguistics. And you may speculate why she went bad and decided to go to law school. I can't answer that. But I can say I asked her who was the most impressive professor of linguistics with whom she had studied in MIT. And in a nanosecond, she said, Noam Chomsky. He was a man whose work in syntactic structures has literally changed his field. He is regarded as one of the great public intellectuals on that basis alone. But he has had a career as the equivalent to our modern Socrates, a gadfly who has raised issues across a wide gamut of topics, always uncompromising, always fearless, always willing to speak truth to power, always willing to raise sometimes uncomfortable topics in uncomfortable ways, but because of his commitment, as worthy of veneration as any, to proudly and sometimes defiantly speak what he believes is the truth, and to try to advance all of us. In a recent work, Because We Say So, Henry Giroux in his foreword stated, and I quote, Chomsky's role intellectually, educationally, and politically is more relevant now than ever, given the need for a display of civic courage, theoretic rigor, and willingness to translate oppression and suffering into public concerns. Moreover, he provides a model for young people and others to understand the importance of using ideas and knowledge to intervene in civic, political, and cultural life, making it clear that democracy has to be struggled over if it is going to survive. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Noam Chomsky. I'm too eager. Please join me in welcoming Professor William Fitzpatrick, who will introduce.
Boy, was that a disappointment for you, right? So you're hoping for him, you get me. Well, I know time is short, so and you're here to hear Professor Chomsky, not me, so I'll be brief, I promise. And we should have about a half an hour for Q&A at the end, and there's also a reception afterwards, and I'll say nearby at the Eisenberg Rotunda, and I'll say more about that later. So the Distinguished Visiting Humanist Program was established 5 years ago with a generous commitment from President Seligman. It's now a central feature of our new Humanities Center, which exists in large part thanks to the initiative and support of Dean Culver. And I think this is a really wonderful culmination of a rich and successful first year for the center under Joni Rubin's enlightened and energetic leadership. So many thanks to all of you and to other people who helped organize this and to the event staff for making this possible. From the beginning, the idea for this program, the Distinguished Visiting Humanist Program, was to find the very most prominent and influential scholars working on broadly humanistic questions and to bring them to campus for several days of talks and meetings with various groups of faculty, students, and members of the Rochester community. We were told, reach for the stars. So we did, and boy, did we get one. Noam Chomsky is commonly referred to as not only the father of modern linguistics, but as perhaps the most influential public intellectual alive. He's done seminal work in a variety of academic fields and is an equally well-known public presence as an uncompromising social and political critic. Over half a century, he's worked to expose the darker sides of capitalism, the hypocrisies of many uses of political power, and the manipulations of information and rhetoric that subvert meaningful democracy. His voice is at bottom, I think, a distinctly and deeply moral one, insisting on the simple premise that what really matters are human beings and human development and flourishing. When it comes to powerful human institutions and the policies that govern them, they should always be viewed through that lens, the question in every case being who is served by them and how well. And obviously, we should demand that they actually serve ordinary people and serve them well. Now, these may seem like truisms, but as Professor Chomsky has pointed out in various contexts, truisms are often ignored or outright rejected in practice, and these are no exception. Now, the inspiration for inviting Professor Chomsky as our distinguished visiting humanist came specifically from reading an account of the recent Dewey lectures that he delivered at Columbia University, which addressed some of the topics that he'll be taking up today. It's hard to think of more fundamental and central humanistic questions than these. What is it that makes us distinctively human? And in particular, what's the essence of language, which sets us so clearly apart from other living creatures? How are the underlying mechanisms of language related to human creativity? And what light might all of this shed on the nature and potential limits of human understanding as we exercise our distinctive cognitive capacities? Well, this was exactly what we were looking for, right? Big questions at the heart of humanistic inquiry, explored by one of the most prolific and penetrating minds of our time. So it's my great pleasure now to give you, finally, Noam Chomsky, who will speak to us about language, creativity, and the limits of understanding.
In the early days of the modern scientific revolution, Galileo and other leading 17th century scientists, philosophers, issued a critical challenge for the study of language and mind, one that is still far from being more than partially addressed. They were awed, I'm now quoting, by the marvelous invention of a means to construct from 25 or 30 sounds an infinite variety of expressions, which, although not having any resemblance in themselves to that which passes through our minds, nevertheless do not fail to reveal all of the secrets of the mind and to make intelligible to others who cannot penetrate into our minds all that we conceive and all the diverse movements of our souls. For Descartes, this was a primary difference between humans and any animal or machine. The insight provided a primary basis for his well-known mind-body dualism, facts that are still poorly understood. I'll actually return to that. Later on, the great humanist, linguist, Wilhelm von Humboldt, conceived language, in his words, to be a productive activity that makes articulated sound capable of expressing thought, audible signs for thought, in the words of William Dwight Whitney, a famous figure in 19th century linguistics. For the last great representative of this tradition, Otto Jespersen, about a century ago, the central question of the study of language, again his words, is how its structures come into existence in the mind of a speaker on the basis of limited, finite experience, yielding a notion of structure that is definite enough to guide him in framing sentences of his own, crucially what he called free expressions that are typically new to speaker and hearer. For convenience, I'll refer to this tradition as the Galilean challenge, taking a little bit of liberty with texts, but not in a way that affects the main point. The Galilean challenge is, I think, of crucial significance for the study of the nature and evolution of language and the human mind. One might say, I think without exaggeration, that it virtually defines the topic, that any approach that doesn't at least try to deal with the challenge is deeply flawed and happens to cover a lot of ground. The Galilean challenge concerns what has been sometimes called the creative aspect of language use, the distinctive human capacity to construct in our minds an infinite number of thoughts expressed in language and to use them to reveal our thoughts to others in ways that are appropriate to circumstances. And we could add to bring them to our own consciousness sometimes and our own understanding. That's actually a crucial, though very little studied topic, one for new students to undertake, direct new directions. Human language and thought are, for this reason, based on a generative process, which is my the modern study of these topics, motivated by the Galilean challenge, has been called the generative enterprise. It's an enterprise which began to take shape in the mid-20th century, aided by new theoretical understanding of the nature of computational systems. The idea that human language and human thought have a fundamental creative aspect based on a generative process was suggested, as far as I know, for the first time by the 16th century Spanish physician, philosopher, Juan Huarte, who apparently influenced Descartes. Huarte distinguished three kinds of intelligence. The lowest level is shared by humans and animals and lacks the creative capacity. The second level, specific to humans, is based on a generative system that underlies the normal use of language. In Huarte's words, people who have this system can be seen inventing and saying such things as they never heard from their masters nor any mouth. That's the second level of intelligence. The third and highest level is true creativity with aesthetic value, which he suggests might involve a mixture of madness, thoughts derived from Plato originally. In a recent discussion of language and understanding, the Dewey lectures that Bill mentioned, I wrote that honesty should lead us to concede that we understand little more about creativity than Huarte did in the 16th century. Nor do we even know whether the essential questions fall within the scope of human understanding, or whether they are what David Hume took to be nature's ultimate secrets, consigned to that obscurity in which they ever did and ever will remain. Hume was referring to the Newtonian scientific revolution, which had just taken place, based on invocation of forces that Newton and his contemporaries regarded as an absurdity, Newton's words, for quite compelling reasons, which have only deepened in the years since. Quite interesting topic, I'll put it aside here. Relevant here is the question to what extent the Galilean challenge falls within the reach of potential human intelligence. I might add that it is very commonly argued that there are no limits to human intelligence. There is no ignorabimus, as the great mathematician philosopher David Hilbert declared. As he put it, there are absolutely no unsolvable problems. Instead of the foolish ignorabimus, our answer is, on the contrary, we must know, we shall know, words that are engraved on his tombstone. And they're widely accepted today, particularly by those who consider themselves to be scientific naturalists. That's always seemed to me very strange, not only for the reasons that impelled John Locke, David Hume, Isaac Newton himself to reject the conclusion, quite strong arguments, but also because more generally, we are, after all, organic creatures, we're not angels, so that all of our capacities should be expected to have limits, which in fact are implicit in the fact that they have scope. So our biological endowment permits us to grow arms and legs, but for exactly the same reason, it prevents us from growing wings. And the logic carries over to the cognitive domain. It's been discussed significantly by one figure, the great 19th century philosopher logician Charles Sanders Peirce. He argued persuasively, I think, that our reasoning in science and ordinary life is guided by what he called abductive principles, which crucially limit the range of the hypotheses that we are capable of entertaining. And otherwise, he argues, I think again convincingly, that learning and discovery would be impossible. But these very same principles render other hypotheses either inaccessible or so remote in some accessibility hierarchy that they can't be entertained. In fact, there's little reason to believe that we have even the intellectual resources to pose the correct questions, let alone to find the answers. And this being the case, as I think it is, our sciences can be regarded as a domain of convergence between our innate intellectual capacities and the truths about the world, a convergence that might well be partial apart from some biological miracle. And I think the close study of language sheds some further light on these matters, one of its interests, I think. Well, returning to the Galilean challenge, it's important to determine which parts are amenable to study and which parts lie beyond reach, quite possibly for reasons that have to do with limits of human understanding. As formulated, the Galilean challenge identifies thought with linguistically formulable thought. Again, the words of the challenge say that these 25 to 30 sounds can reveal all that we conceive and all the diverse movements of our souls. That's an identification of thought with linguistically expressible thought. That idea runs through a long tradition, finds expression today. I think it's too extreme. There seems good evidence for thought that's not linguistically articulated or articulable. Nevertheless, what can in principle be formulated in language is surely a core component of what's loosely described as thought. And restricting ourselves to that, we ask, what kind of mental structure would satisfy the Galilean criteria? And the challenge for science is to discover what this entity is, how it functions, and if possible, how it evolved, how we happen to have it. On the latter topic, in recent years, there's been a huge and burgeoning literature on evolution of language. There's regular international conferences, many publications. However, it's rarely noted that the topic doesn't exist. Languages change, but they don't evolve. And what evolved is something different, namely the capacity for language, which is part of the human biological endowment. Each language is an instantiation of the language capacity, just as each visual system, individual visual system, is an instantiation of the shared human visual capacity. It's the capacity that evolved and not its instantiations. You might think that this is just a terminological point, but actually if you look further, the problem goes considerably deeper. Soon we see that as soon as you look into the literature on the topic. Much of it denies that there is a linguistic capacity. It adopts a principle which was famously announced by prominent psychologist, linguist Michael Tomasello, that the language capacity is dead. There is no such thing. His actual words were, UG is dead, which is exactly the same thing. UG, universal grammar, is nothing other than the theory of the language capacity. So if that's dead, there's no language capacity. So in short, much of the field, I think probably most of it, is based on the assumption that the topic doesn't exist. That may seem uncharitable, worth some thought, merits further discussion. You might want to look into it. I'll put the question aside here. Discussed it elsewhere. The Galilean challenge presupposes what's been called in recent years the biolinguistic program. It assumes that the language capacity is a real biological entity. It's a component of the mind-brain, kind of parallel to the visual capacity in others. That was quite a departure from the prevailing approaches of the structuralist behavioral science period, 1940s and 50s, and also recent reincarnations of the same conceptions. But nevertheless, if we adopt this program, the biolinguistic program, we at once face two central questions. The question of learnability, as Jespersen emphasized, and since Darwin, the question of evolvability. The study of learnability and evolvability was given quite solid grounding by Eric Lenneberg, old friend, in his classic text, Biological Foundations of Language, came out in 1967. And among his many contributions, several are of particular significance in the present context. Lenneberg reviewed the sharp divergence between human language and the symbolic systems of other animals, and he also presented the first serious, comprehensive account of is this working? Lost.
Magic touch. Why don't you?
We were just commenting that this illustrates the limits of human understanding. Actually, I'm at MIT, a great technological institution, and at least once during in commencement, the whole public address system breaks down. So, and in fact, the most interesting case in my experience when I was giving memorial lectures for Bertrand Russell at Trinity College in Cambridge, England, and in the middle, somebody ran up and said, "We have to clear the whole room. There's a bomb threat." So everybody went outside and came back a little later and picked up where we had left. So this is kind of mild. Well, going back to Eric Lenneberg, to repeat, he discussed the sharp divergence between human language and any animal communication system, and a second topic, the quite sharp divergence between the human language capacity and other human cognitive capacities. Many cases, some of which he discovered, in which one of them functions and the other fails, both directions. These discoveries and insights have been considerably extended and deepened since Lenneberg's work. He also discussed the biological plausibility of discontinuity in evolution, what's sometimes called saltation. It was a radical idea at that time. It's a conclusion that's much better grounded today, and it's actually a logical necessity to account for the emergence of systems like human language, which is a system of discrete infinity, as the Galilean challenge recognized. And that can't emerge in steps, can't get from a small number to infinity by small steps. And this capacity, this system of discrete infinity, it may actually be unique, perhaps even in the biological world, and the root of others that are known, such as knowledge of arithmetic, for example, problem that very much bothered Darwin. The language capacity appears to be a true species capacity, unique to humans in essentials and invariant among human groups. The evidence is quite persuasive that the language capacity has undergone little, probably no, evolutionary change, at least since our ancestors left Africa, so estimated about some 60,000 years ago. And there are very recent genomic studies, last few months in fact, studies of African groups that separated much earlier, and these indicate that there has been little or no evolutionary change in the language capacity for over 100,000 years. Now the Homo sapiens emerged about 200,000 years ago, and that gap is virtually nothing in evolutionary time. There's no evidence that anything like the language capacity existed prior to Homo sapiens. So what the evidence indicates is that the language capacity emerged pretty much with Homo sapiens, maybe simultaneous with it, and it hasn't changed since. These facts bear directly on the fundamental nature of the language capacity. They very strongly suggest that the language capacity, whatever it is, must be quite simple at its core, both because of its apparently rapid emergence in the evolutionary record and its resistance to modification ever since. Now, it's because of the apparent universality and stability of the language capacity that the theory of the language capacity has been called universal grammar, UG for short. It's recent decades. That's actually adapting a traditional notion which had a different interpretation, adapting it to a new biological context. In current literature, unfortunately, the universal grammar, UG, is often confused with something different, namely generalizations that are generally correct about surface properties of languages. It's quite an interesting topic, but a different one. Another common misunderstanding is that the argument for particular theses of UG is that they hold universally. That could not be a very good argument. There could be many reasons for universality, for example, common origin. The basic arguments for theses of UG lie in the study of learnability, what's called poverty of stimulus in the study of language, a problem that arises in all forms of growth and development. The complexity of the system that arises is not traceable to properties of the data that are the basis for it. So, for example, you can't derive the fact that humans have a mammalian visual system, not an insect visual system, from looking at the nutritional environment of the embryo, for example. Nobody believes that. And the same is true in the cognitive domain. Well, returning to the Galilean challenge, until mid-20th century, the challenge had been pretty much ignored. There's occasional notice of the kind I mentioned, and in fact, doesn't go much beyond that. It's very occasional. And there was a good reason for it. Tools were not available for even formulating the challenge clearly. That problem was overcome by mid-20th century as a result of great mathematical work by Gödel, Turing, Church, others, which established the theory of computability on very firm grounds and made it very clear how a finite system can generate an infinite array of objects. These discoveries made it possible for the first time to capture precisely some of the ideas that animated the tradition. And again, I stress some of them, and I'll get back to that, and to pursue them effectively for the first time. The language capacity that has evolved is a generative system that yields an infinite array of structured expressions that constitute thoughts linguistically expressed and that can be externalized into one or another sensory modality. Typically that's sound, not necessarily, as you can see. I'll keep the sound for convenience, but it's just one of possible modalities. The language doesn't seem to care which modality you use. In the standard terminology, technical terminology, the generative system yields representations at two interfaces with other internal systems. What's called the conceptual intentional interface provides linguistically formulated thought, kind of language of thought, sometimes it's called, and the sensory-motor interfaces, one or another modality, that provides modes for externalizing thought. Well, let's start looking more closely at the Galilean challenge, separating out those components that are amenable to study and those that are beyond the realm of careful inquiry, now at least, possibly forever. The first distinction is between the generative system and the use of the system. Familiar terms for that are competence and performance. There is a legitimate controversy about how competence and performance interact in accounting for particular phenomena, but the distinction itself is not in question. It's an elementary conceptual distinction. It's familiar in such simple areas as, say, arithmetic. So you and your laptop have an internal generative system for arithmetic. Now that's intrinsic competence. You and your laptop can access this system for various actions, say producing the product of two numbers. And in carrying out multiplication or other arithmetical operations, there may be many deviations from what the internal system determines. The reason is that all sorts of other factors enter into actual performance, both for you and your laptop. That distinction between generation and production is fundamental and quite important to keep in mind. It's worth noting that the Galilean tradition challenge and the tradition that followed from it didn't make the distinction, and they could not, lacking the 20th century clarification of the nature of computability. The Galilean challenge, as you can see from the wording I quoted, was formulated in terms of production, not generation, two very different notions. Production is one of two aspects of performance. Performance includes input systems and output systems. The input systems are perception, in case of language, parsing, a technique for determining the structure of the sentence and the meaning of the sentence from its physical character. The output systems are production. A standard view is that the input system, parsing, perception, is basically a reflex. That's the phrase of psycholinguist Merrill Garrett, Jerry Fodor, important philosopher, described this as the deepest observation he ever heard about the mechanisms underlying perception of speech. It's the inspiration for his influential modularity theories, which some of you may know about, which incidentally are restricted to input systems. If that's accurate, as it seems to be, we can put it aside here. It's a very interesting topic, has quite far-reaching results, but it's unrelated to the Galilean challenge. It's a reflex. And in fact, the topic seems to have been ignored in the tradition to which I referred, probably for this reason. So the Galilean challenge then reduces to generation, intrinsic competence, and to production. Well, let's take production, the other aspect of performance. We can stare at the problem, but there's nothing much of interest to say about it, at least those aspects of production that have been at the heart that animated the Galilean challenge through the centuries, what I call the creative aspect of language use, the use of language that is appropriate to circumstances, but not determined by them, fundamental distinction. So in Cartesian terms, we may be incited or inclined to speak in certain ways, but we are not compelled to do so, fundamental distinction. And that is true more generally of voluntary action. Actually, the problem is expressed graphically in a recent review of the state of the art by two leading neuroscientists who work on voluntary action, Emilio Bizzi, Robert Ajamian. They write, I'm quoting them, "We have some idea as to the intricate design of the puppet and the puppet strings, but we lack insight into the mind of the puppeteer, what's making it happen." They're concerned with very simple cases, like, say, the decision to lift your finger or to shift your eye gaze. And it's dramatically true in the vastly more complex case of production of language. So if you consider an aphorism of Wilhelm von Humboldt, now sometimes quoted, that language involves infinite use of finite means, we now have some idea about the means that are used, the internal language, the puppet and the strings, but it's the generative process, but not the infinite use, not the puppeteer. As in the case of voluntary motion generally, the fundamental questions about the use of the means by the puppeteer remain shrouded in mystery. The matter is often misinterpreted in current scientific work. For example, there's a good deal of work comparing speech and organization of actual speech and organization of other actions. Contrary to what's assumed in this work, that would tell us virtually nothing about language. It would tell us something about the organization of the particular act of speaking, which of course is going to share properties with other acts, but tells us nothing about the fundamental, the generative system, the creative aspect of language use. Actually, there are serious misinterpretations, even in the finest academic scholarship. It happens to be a case in point in an article that just appeared on Descartes by one of the leading scholars of early modern philosophy, John Cottingham. Cottingham actually is unusual in that he recognizes that the creative aspect of language use provided a basis for Descartes' mind-body dualism, and he also recognizes, and this is rare, that it was an empirical argument concerning the limitations of any machine, all of which is correct. But the way he puts it is interestingly incorrect. I'll quote it. The way he puts it is that Descartes believed that a machine could not possibly generate the indefinitely large range of responses needed for genuine thought or language. But he goes on to say that a Turing machine, which is basically your laptop, can run an indefinite number of programs and tackle an indefinite number of tasks, and thus has new technology refuted old arguments. So Cottingham concludes, but it doesn't. Descartes could easily have handled the fact, would not have been surprised by the fact that a machine can generate infinitely many responses. He was interested in something else, quite different. Now, the limits of a machine are that they cannot, in Descartes' words, respond appropriately to circumstances. Not that it was finitely bounded. That was not a concern in the 17th century. He was concerned with the difference between being incited or inclined to speak in certain ways and being compelled to do so. The machine is compelled. The person is only incited or inclined and somehow chooses, the puppeteer somehow chooses to act appropriately. That's the mystery, the problem. That's the question that animated the Galilean challenge from the beginning, still does, and the puppeteer still escapes our intellectual grasp. In fact, it's not even clear that we know how to formulate the questions properly. Simple cases of voluntary motion, like, say, raising your finger, deciding to raise your finger, those are mysterious enough. But there's something almost magical about production of a sentence or an internal thought, which you don't bother externalizing. If you think about it for a minute, this, if you produce a sentence, sorry? Okay. How's that? Yeah, okay. Well, to go back a sentence, the simple voluntary actions like shifting your eye gaze or lifting your finger, the decision to carry them out are totally mysterious. But the question becomes vastly more complex, in fact, kind of almost magical, when you think about producing in your mind a complex sentence, sometimes externalizing it. If you think about it, the sentence that you produce emerges instantaneously in all of its complexity, with no awareness of any acts of composing it in your mind. And in fact, we by now know a good deal about the intricacies of what's going on when it's composed in the mind, but no one can become conscious of this. You can't become conscious of these internal mental acts. And the only plausible conclusion is that the act of formulating thoughts, sometimes externalizing them in sound, these acts are unconscious, inaccessible to consciousness. Nonetheless, the puppeteer appears to be acting freely and independently and somehow appropriately. Here, the mysteries just abound. Well, we're led to conclude from all of this that performance actually does not bear on the Galilean challenge. In the case of production, because it's out of reach in its interesting aspects. In the case of parsing and perception, because it's well within reach and an important topic, but not relevant to the challenge. So we're therefore left with competence on the generative system, the internal language computational system that generates something like a language of thought at the conceptual intentional interface, and instructions for articulation or other actions at the sensory motor interface. Now that's where we are left in trying to deal with the Galilean challenge. Well, take a look at that. Any computational system consists of atomic elements that are unanalyzed for the purposes of the computation, and a procedure, so-called recursive procedure, that forms more complex objects. So let's take a look at the atoms, constituting what's technically called the lexicon. The atoms include the minimal, meaning-bearing elements of language. And here again, we face fundamental and perhaps insuperable problems. The terms and concepts of human thought and human language appear to have no counterpart in animal communication systems. In all animal systems, there's invariably a direct correlation between the symbol, say an animal call, and some identifiable mind external event, say the cries of a monkey, can be elicited by fluttering of leaves. We take that to be a predator warning call, monkeys start running away, or say by some hormonal change, we take that to mean I'm hungry or something like that, and so on. That generalizes without known exception, including the bee, complicated bee communication system. But all that's radically false for human language. That's a matter that becomes quite evident when you consider the simplest, most fundamental elements that are used to talk about the world, to refer, to relate thoughts to the non-linguistic world. These elements simply do not conform to what's called the representationalist doctrine, the doctrine that there's a direct relation between the symbols of thought and language and some mind external thing. That's a doctrine that's almost universally adopted in the related disciplines captured in the titles of classic modern works such as W.V. Quine's Word and Object, Roger Brown's Word and Things. And the doctrine does apparently hold for animal systems, but it fails completely for human systems, for the elements of human thought and language. They just don't pick out mind-independent objects. No time to go into it, but it's quite striking. And in fact, it was understood long ago. It was understood and discussed in classical Greece. It was explored in the 17th and 18th century, British philosophical classics, Locke, Hume, and others. But it's been largely forgotten in the modern period. And because of the force of the representationalist doctrine, I think we could say dogma, because of the force of that dogma, the inquiry into these elements has really not been seriously undertaken. The nature of the elementary terms and concepts has barely been explored. And as far as their evolutionary origin is concerned, that's a complete mystery. Interesting, important topic, but I'll put that one aside too. Lack of time. Carving away what is irrelevant to the Galilean challenge, or what is beyond reach, what's left to investigate is the nature and evolutionary origin of the recursive procedure that generates the two interface representations. And that, in fact, has been the major topic of inquiry since the Galilean challenge was undertaken, first addressed in the mid-20th century. Well, in the prevailing structuralist behavioral science environment, it was generally assumed at the time, 40s and 50s, that the nature of language was quite well understood, and that what remained was sort of to fill in the details for the various languages of the world, which it was assumed could vary limitlessly in character. As soon as the first attempts were made to describe languages in ways that satisfy the Galilean criteria with what are called generative grammars, it was very quickly discovered that the opposite was more nearly true. Almost nothing was understood, and serious puzzles abounded everywhere. Now, the first attempts to deal with the problem, to construct generative grammars, were extremely complex, simply in order to try to capture newly discovered and quite surprising data. But it was always understood that this cannot be correct because of the problems of learnability and evolvability that are always lurking in the background. Well, over the years, considerable simplification has been carried out, while the empirical range of inquiry has been greatly extended, both in depth and scope. I won't run through the history, but it seems that now we're maybe able, for the first time, to address the Galilean challenge in a more principled way, to ask, how far can we go with the simplest possible assumptions? So we therefore explore what has been called the strong minimalist thesis, SMT, which suggests as an ideal that the system that emerged pretty much along with Homo sapiens was close to perfect, satisfying general principles of computational efficiency, basically laws of nature, but with no selectional pressures, which would introduce complexities. So it'd be basically kind of like a snowflake, which assumes its complex structure just because of laws of nature. It doesn't evolve to become like that. Well, in pursuing this course, we're actually following the standard model of the sciences, which is based on the recognition that greater simplicity translates into deeper explanation. We're also following the Galilean maxim, which has driven modern science, that nature is basically simple, and it's the task of the scientist to show that. And if the scientist hasn't shown that, something's wrong. There's a relevant comment by the late Princeton physicist John Wheeler, who points out that by pushing a theory to its extremes, we also find where the cracks in its structure must be hiding. That's the viewpoint that guides current astronomy, according to astrophysicist Pedro Ferreira. And in the case of language, this stance is independently motivated by what's known about the evolution of the language capacity. It's apparently quite sudden emergence in evolutionary history, essentially simultaneous with Homo sapiens, and its stability since, as I already mentioned. So turning to the simplest recursive operation, which is buried somewhere in every computational system, what it does is take objects that are already constructed, two in the simplest case, and it forms a new one, adding no additional structure, not changing either. That's the core of computation. Basically, binary set formations, what's called merge in recent literature. So the question we can ask is, how far can we go in explaining basic properties of language with just this operation, the core operation of any computational system? And the answer, it turns out, is pretty far, surprisingly. I won't run through the details, it's rather technical, but I'll just mention some of the consequences of adopting a simplest assumption for the computational system of internal language. I'm not trying to demonstrate this here, that's done elsewhere, but just talk about what the results are. One consequence is a solution to a long-standing puzzle called the puzzle of structure dependence of rules, which is a highly puzzling phenomenon, which was never noticed until the first efforts were made to construct generative grammars back around the 1950s. The puzzle is that linguistic operations universally ignore the very simple computation of linear distance, and they use instead the much more complex computation of structural distance. Those of you who saw Michel Gondry's film last night, the title was, Is the Man Who Is Tall Happy?, which is one illustration of this extremely puzzling property. Take an even simpler example. Consider the sentence, birds that fly instinctively swim. It's ambiguous. Could mean fly instinctively or instinctively swim. Now suppose you extract the adverb, put it in the front, and you get instinctively birds that fly swim. That's unambiguous. It means instinctively swim, not instinctively fly, which means that the adverb is ignoring the linearly closest verb, fly, and it's selecting the structurally closest verb, swim, which is a much more complex computation. That holds for all languages, all relevant constructions. Now, there happens to be interesting supporting evidence in this case from neuroscience and psycholinguistics, which you could mention if you like. Now, there's only one known explanation for these quite striking facts. Now, the explanation is that UG satisfies the strong minimalist thesis. From that assumption, it just follows. It follows that linear order is just never entertained by the child learning a language, never considers that option in computing the language of thought, the conceptual intentional interface. In fact, linear order and other arrangements appear to be properties that are imposed by the sensory motor system. So we can't talk in parallel. We can't articulate structures. So the internal computations that yield the linguistically expressible thoughts, the language of thought, they have to be externalized in a way that passes through the sensory motor filter, meet sensory motor conditions. Now, these are quite independent of language, have nothing to do with language. Now, they were in place in the evolutionary record long before language emerged. Sign language, as you can see, involves somewhat different arrangements because the medium simply allows other options. Another consequence of the strong minimalist thesis is an explanation for the ubiquitous property of what's called displacement. Phrases appear in one place, but they're interpreted both there and somewhere else. So for example, in the sentence, which books did John read? We interpret the phrase, which books, where we hear it, and also as the object of read. So the meaning of the sentence is something like, for which books X? John read the books X. We interpret it in both positions. And these results can become quite intricate when you take sentences of any minimal complexity. Well, this has always been assumed to be a strange imperfection of human language. It's a property you would never build into artificial systems like computer languages or metamathematical systems. So why is it there? Well, there are various notations for expressing it. One can discuss their advantages and disadvantages, but that's kind of beside the point. The real question is, why is it there in the first place? That's rarely addressed. But it does turn out to follow directly from this strong minimalist thesis, another quite surprising result. And as a side benefit, it happens to give the correct forms for semantic interpretation, as in the example that I just gave. Which books did he read? If you take a look at what's generated, it's which books did John read, which books, which is directly interpreted. And that's for linguists the so-called copy theory of movement, a phenomenon called reconstruction in the technical literature, and it all falls out immediately from the strong minimalist thesis. And another rather related consequence of the thesis is a very striking disparity between what's generated at the thought interface and the sensory motor interface, informally what reaches the mind and what reaches the ear. What reaches the mind are the forms appropriate for semantic interpretation, for reasoning, for inference, for planning, thought, language of thought again. What reaches the ear causes severe problems for parsing and perception, for one reason, because of the deletion of copies, which happens to be in conformity with a minimal computation, strong minimalist thesis again. So again, in the simple example I gave, what reaches the mind is which books John read, which books, directly interpretable. What reaches the ear is which books John read. Now that has a gap in it, and the gap has to be filled in by the hearer or the automatic parser. And that task becomes quite intricate when you go beyond the simplest examples. In fact, these so-called filler gap problems are among the most complex problems for automatic parsing and also for perception. More generally, turns out that whenever there's a conflict between computational efficiency and communicative efficiency, communicative efficiency is sacrificed. It's just nobody pays any attention, the language doesn't pay any attention to it. To put it a bit metaphorically, language seems to be designed for internal thought, not for use. The internal linguistically constructed thought need not appear consciously in externalized form. It's another matter that deserves more explanation, more exploration. I'll put it aside here. These conclusions lead directly to another conclusion, namely that a widely held doctrine is incorrect, namely that the prime function of language is communication, and that language evolved as an animal-like communication system. Now, that appears to be quite incorrect. Rather, it seems increasingly clear that language is primarily an instrument of thought, with such uses as communication, a kind of secondary, ancillary phenomenon. Now, that is yet another striking dissociation between human language and animal symbolic systems. And more generally, there's mounting evidence that there's a fundamental asymmetry between the two interfaces. A generation of the thoughts is the core of language, and the mapping of the core language to the sensory motor system is ancillary. Its properties are substantially a reflex of the sensory motor system, which again evolved long before language emerged and probably has little or nothing to do with language. Well, what we would expect then is that externalization to the sensory motor system would be complex. Why? Because it's relating to unrelated systems. Core internal language, which is maybe kind of a snowflake, and the sensory motor systems, which are around for a long time before language. And it does seem correct. It seems that the complexity, the diversity, the easy mutability of language resides largely, and perhaps we'll discover someday completely, in externalization. So when you learn a second language, or for that matter, when a child acquires the first language, the task is to acquire the externalization. That includes the arbitrary assignment of sound to lexical items, word order, morphological patterns, peculiarities, irregular verbs, and so on. There's no way to learn the principle of structure dependence or the curious phenomena of, say, quantifier variable interaction in reconstruction or the properties of expressions of more than the minimal complexity, or for that matter, even the meanings of words, which are incomparably more intricate than the hints that you find in even the most extensive dictionary, say the OED, Oxford, the biggest of the dictionaries. All of this is simply unlearnable. It appears that the core system of the that yields the language of thought is probably uniform among languages, or virtually so, and perhaps even satisfying something like the strong minimalist thesis. And that conclusion, if it turns out to be true, should not be too surprising, since the child who's learning a language has virtually no evidence about any of this, often literally none. So it has to derive from what David Hume called the original hand of nature. In our terms, some rewiring of the brain, probably simultaneous with the emergence of Homo sapiens, tracing ultimately to some genetic endowment. Just what this biological endowment is remains unknown, and that too is not surprising. Biologists have observed that even for far simpler traits, finding their genetic basis can be fiendishly difficult, quoting a technical book. But in this case, it's perhaps at least potentially within the range of inquiry. Well, in general, to conclude, the strong minimalist thesis yields quite rich consequences. There's a vast range still unexplored in anything like these terms, which means that there's a vast range of work, compelling, challenging work within the range of inquiry, and deep mysteries that lie beyond. The Galilean challenge can be partially met and in revealing ways, but we're very far from addressing the concerns of the suggestive, though often obscure, tradition, and there's no guarantee that they're even within the potential reach of human inquiry, in part because the evidence may be unattainable, but in part because of our intrinsic limitations as organic creatures. That roughly seems to me the general lay of the land today. Thank you.
I am intrigued by the statement that our biological endowment does not give us the ability to grow wings, and the observation that it does give us the ability through a lengthy process of bootstrapping to build a machine that has wings.
That has?
A machine that has wings, an airplane. Oh, we build tools with which we build more complex tools, with which we build yet more complex tools that eventually allow us to build an airplane. And I'm left wondering how much of that process applies in the cognitive domain. To what extent may we be able to build machines that help us conceive new machines, that help us conceive new machines, and eventually understand things that as biological organisms alone we cannot understand?
Good question. And in fact, that's the question. I'm sorry, is this, can you hear me? Yeah, I'll be a little closer. What you're describing is, in fact, what interested early modern science. So Leonardo da Vinci conceived of an airplane. Couldn't build it at that time, but he could conceive of it. The thinking of the early modern revolution, Galileo up through Newton, which is the foundations of modern science, was based on what was called the mechanical philosophy. The idea that the world is a machine, the universe is a machine, the kind of thing that could be constructed by a master craftsman, and in fact was constructed by the ultimately skilled master craftsman. That was the fundamental idea of the modern scientific revolution. So Galileo, for example, argued that if you can't construct a machine, and machine means just what you're describing, gears, levers, you know, things pushing and pulling each other, and so on. If you can't construct a machine to explain some natural phenomenon, you failed. And in fact, he felt at the end of his life that his scientific career was a failure because he was not able to construct a machine to account for the tides or the motion of the heavenly bodies and so on. And that goes right up to Newton. Newton's great discovery was the world isn't a machine. It's not a machine. It has what were called occult elements, forces like action at a distance or repulsion at a distance. And that's not part, the machines can't do that. So the amazing discovery is the world simply isn't a machine. Newton, as I mentioned, regarded this as a complete absurdity. He never accepted it, spent the rest of his life trying to disprove it. Other great scientists of the day regarded it as ridiculous, Leibniz, Huygens, and so on. And for a long time afterwards, the scientists did try to show somehow that the mechanical science could account for the world. Ultimately, Newton's proofs just became scientific common sense, that people gave up the enterprise. And science changed radically from trying to show that the world is intelligible to us, which was given up, to trying to show that we can construct theories that are intelligible to us. And that's something quite different. It's a radical change in the nature of science that took place. It was understood by Locke and Hume. Now, that's why Hume, in his, if you read his History of England, where he has a chapter on Newton, you know, the greatest genius who ever appeared, he points out that his great achievement was to lift the veil from some of the mysteries of nature, but to show that there are other mysteries which we will never penetrate, which turns out to be correct. Science has just changed its objectives. It's lowered them. And when you come to your question, we just don't know. There's every reason to suppose, I think, that cognitive capacities are like all other capacities. They're biological capacities. And it's just part of the logic of a biological capacity that if it has any scope at all, it's going to have limits. The reason it has scope is because of some of its intrinsic properties. So we have intrinsic genetic properties that determine that from the nutrition of the cell, of the embryo, we end up with a mammalian visual system. But by that same token, these same properties tell us that no matter what the nutrition of the embryo, we're not going to get an insect visual system. Scope and limits are logically related. And that actually was Peirce's insight that I quoted about abductive principles. He's often misunderstood. So in modern contemporary philosophy, Peirce's argument, philosophers among you will know, is often interpreted as what's called inference to the best explanation. But that's not what he said at all. What he discussed was the idea, which I think is plausible, that you can't learn or discover anything unless there's some initial limitation of the hypothesis space. It has to somehow be limited to particular hypotheses. And in support of this, he discussed the history of science, and he points out that if you look at scientific revolutions, quite typically, when particular circumstances exist, a particular level of understanding, particular problems being formulated, there are often many people who come to pretty much the same conclusion. Some of them get there first, and we attribute it to them, but others are pretty near. And the reason, he argued, is that these conditions are somehow putting in operation our internal abductive principles, he didn't know what they were, and we don't know what they are, that limit the hypothesis space. So you explore certain hypotheses, and not an infinite number of others that are consistent with the evidence. And the same has to be true of learning. Just couldn't get off the ground unless the child's hypothesis space is highly limited. And in fact, we're coming to understand very limited. So that gets to your question. How far can our abductive principles reach?
And who knows? Could a cyborg reach farther?
Thank you. We'll move over here next question.
Yes, Professor Chomsky, I'm wondering about the concept of when we feel that we understand or grasp or make sense of something that we've been told or observed. And if I understood you correctly, you said that there is evidence that there is thought without language. And I'm wondering if that process would fit into that, if you could just say a little bit more about thought without language and if how that relates to our feeling, if that's the right word, it may not be the right word, of when we understand or grasp something.
What's the relation between language and the feelings
and
that we have
and
when we understand
something?
When
it seems
understand
to be done without, it can be done without language, it appears. And I'm wondering if that relates to your point that there is some evidence that we can think
that
without
can,
the use of
we
language.
Can, we can
think without the use of language.
Can think without the use of language. Well, I mean, just take, say, ordinary circumstances. So suppose I'm trying to figure out how to get to work in the morning. I live in Boston, and like other cities in the United States, everything's collapsing. Infrastructure is disappearing. It's beginning to look like the third world. So there's going to be a lot of detours, you know, construction here, this is going to be blocked. And kind of instantaneously in your mind, you work out various images of possible ways to get through this maze. You just can't articulate that in words. But I think that's thought. And I think there are a lot of things like that. The idea that language is strictly thought, though it is the traditional view and still articulated, it just doesn't seem to me to conform to simple introspection.
Thank you.
Hi. So there has recently been a program developed to try to change machine learning from a set of rules to basically probabilistic guessing. Do you think this type of program could be used to teach computer language? And if not, what aspects of language do you think would fail to be replicated?
Through probabilistic models?
Yes.
I mean, there's a place for probabilistic models in the study of language or study of anything. But it doesn't carry very far. The fundamental problems remain the same. So probabilistic models just tell you nothing about the creative aspect of language use, about the gap, the fundamental gap between incited and inclined and compelled. Now, there is a place for them. And in fact, there's interesting work on it. So some of the most interesting work on language acquisition by Charles Yang, in this case, a linguist, psychologist at the University of Pennsylvania, it's pretty clear that a child approaches the problem of language acquisition by having all possible languages in its head. It doesn't know which language it's being exposed to. And as data comes along, that class of possible languages reduces. So certain data comes along and the mind automatically says, okay, it's not that language, it's some other language. And in fact, we find in the children's, in literature on child acquisition and experiments with child acquisition, it's been discovered that at various stages, children are imitating possible languages that they've never heard. So at some stage, an English-speaking child can be producing sentences of the kind that appear, say, in Italian or in German, because it just doesn't know yet. It's never heard any data saying that that's the way it ought to be, but that hasn't been ruled out yet. So the child is producing things that are never experiences in the local language, but they remain still not ruled out. Now, if you work out the method of ruling out languages, you do introduce probabilistic inference. And it can lead to some interesting results, as in Yang's work. So there is nothing wrong with statistical inference, it just doesn't carry it very far.
Thank you.
Professor Chomsky, this is going to seem like a selfish departure from the topic at hand, but I wanted to follow up on a question I was asking you yesterday. I made the connection between crowdfunding platforms like Kickstarter and the Bernie Sanders campaign and the way they're financing it. It's not about that. I wanted to ask you to connect it to your work. I was reading your book, Power Systems, the other day, and you were talking about workers actually taking back factories in their area that have been abandoned by corporations that have gone to other countries. And I wanted to, because when I asked you the question, you said, the more important power is like the force of a political revolution, and that's true. But I wonder whether the Bernie Sanders campaign would have had the success that it did if people didn't feel, first of all, that they could click a button and feel that they were contributing money and that they were participating in an organization that they had a stake in, because it was a monetary stake. So I'm asking about the absurd notion of a Kickstarter campaign to, say, buy back abandoned factories, like what you were mentioning in the book, is happening in Spain or something.
This is a very real issue.
Yeah.
It happens over and over that some multinational will close down an operation which happens to be profit-making, but not at the level which satisfies the bookkeeping needs of the multinational. And very often, unions or organized workers have said, okay, we'll buy the factory and keep running it ourselves, and it'll make enough profit for us to live on, we'll be fine. And what happens typically is the multinational refuses, I think for class reasons. They would actually make money if they sold the factory to the workers. But that introduces the idea that working people can just take over the factories and run them by themselves. And that's a dangerous idea. Actually, that's an idea that comes straight out of classical liberalism. So John Stuart Mill, for example, you know, leading figure of classical liberalism, advocated that in a good society, properly run libertarian society, that working people ought to run their own industries. And there are examples that are working. In the old Rust Belt in the United States, you know, Indiana, Ohio, a lot of abandoned, one of the reactions to the abandonment of factories has been to begin worker-owned enterprises that relate to the growing services economy. So let's say a cooperative laundry to fund universities and other institutions in the Cleveland area and things like that. It's proliferating. There's interesting work on it by Garl Perowitz and others. So it's certainly possible. In fact, it could have been possible with the auto industry. If you look back a couple of years ago, the auto industry was collapsing, and the government basically took it over. There were a couple of choices possible at that point. One choice, which was the one that was made, was for the taxpayer to fund it and hand it back essentially to the old management, different names, but basically the same, and have them continue to produce what they'd been producing before, namely automobiles. A different alternative would have been to hand the auto industry over to the workforce and have them produce something that the country desperately needs, which is high-speed transportation. The United States is way behind most of the rest of the world, even countries like China, in lacking efficient high-speed transportation systems. Now, that would be good for the population, be good for the workforce, be good for the environment, but it violates class interests. And since there was no public support for it, what was done was just to restore the old system at taxpayer expense. But it didn't have to be that way. That depends on how people like you will respond to the situation.
Hi, I want to bring it back to linguistics. I'm interested in the atoms or the items that are related by merge. For a language like English, that's reasonably things like words. But what about in a language like Navajo, where the words are massive conglomerations of all sorts of very idiosyncratically combined pieces of meaning? What are the atoms for merge in a language like that?
Probably the same. There is, as you may know, there is study of this. One of the most interesting books is by Mark Baker, Princeton linguist. It's called The Atoms of Language. And he's concerned, Mark, his former student, has been very much concerned all of his academic career with languages that have huge words, what are called polysynthetic languages. And what he's argued is that there's a basic core option of choice that languages have, what's called a parameter, which he called the polysynthesis parameter, and a language can pick one or the other. either way they use merge. They put things together by taking pieces and making bigger theses. In the polysynthetic languages, which give the superficial impression of free word order, what actually is happening is something different. The complex word actually has in it the elements, the meaning-bearing elements. So what looks like a word is actually a complex sentence. And those meaning-bearing elements are keyed to things on the outside, which could be a big phrase, let's say. And they're linked by formal means to the element inside that's performing the semantic function. And what they tell you is this big thing out here is what's performing the semantic function. And that gives you the impression of free, what's called free word order, because these things could appear all over the place. But they're linked to things that have very definite structure, hierarchical structure. So essentially, the basic structure is in this big thing called the polysynthetic word. And there are linkages to pieces floating around on the outside which fulfill the functions that are determined by what they're linked to by some formal element. So it turns out to be pretty much like English-type languages with this slight difference. And Mark's argument is universal grammar is basically fixed.
So with that, let's thank our speaker.